How many times have you heard this? We really can't afford to spend that much on security. Maybe instead we should be asking ourselves if we can afford not to. After all, it's not just about dollars, it's downtime, reputation, lost trust, and the fact is that many of these breaches are preventable. But let's base the decision for security investments on actual numbers rather than just gut feel. The good news is that we have the information in the form of IBM's 2025 Cost of a Data Breach report. In this video, we're going to take a look at some of the key findings and lessons learned from the report that you can apply to your environment. That way, you can make more informed decisions to protect your environment. All right, let's take a look at what's in the Cost of a Data Breach report. First of all, we've been doing this for 20 years. So we're in our 20th year of results. And over those 20 years, we have looked at 6,500 different data breaches and talked to 35,000 tech and business leaders. So that's a lot of data that we have. So the nice thing about that is we can look and not just see what happened at one particular year, we can look and see what's happened over the course of two decades. But the most recent year is the one that we're most interested in. So what did we find in 2025? Well, in this case, we dealt with 600 different organizations and talked to 3,500 business and tech leaders from there. So again, this is not where we just went off and talked to a few people and cherry-picked the data. A lot of people went into this, and all of that goes into the report. And another reason that you can, I tell you these numbers so that you can put some confidence and believe the results that come from it. And another thing that I think also lends a lot of credibility to this is if we were to look at the report and look at, for instance, the number of data breaches graphed across the cost of those data breaches. Well, if you were to graph that, you'd end up, you know, probably with some sort of bell curve looking thing like this, where some of the breaches are super expensive. One over here maybe is a gajillion dollars and one over here was trivial. Well, so what we do in the report is we basically take those results out, the extremely high and extremely low, because you know what that does to averages. One extremely high one would make the entire average, if we were looking at a mean, make it way higher. It would not really be representative. So this way, by doing it, we get a representative sample. And what we report on then is something you can believe in. Okay, so what were the actual numbers? How much does a data breach actually cost? Well, it turns out that for global numbers, if we look at worldwide, the cost of a data breach report actually gives us some good news. It says that the number of overall cost went down 9%. That's good. The number overall, though, for one of those breaches is 4.44 million, which is still a significant number. Every time you get a breach, if that's your average cost, that means obviously there's a bunch that are going to be even more than that. And that's a significant number even of itself. But I'm going to focus on the positive. We got a 9% decrease worldwide. Another positive, and this is one that I like to pay a lot of attention to, is the mean time to identify and mean time to contain. The number of days that it takes to identify that the bad guy is in your system and the number of days it takes for you to clean it up, get him out, and get the situation contained. That also went down, and that's a number that has stayed high for a long time. It's still really not where I think we want it to be, but we'll take some improvement. Back in 2021, these two numbers combined would have been 287 days, versus in 2025, we're down now to 241 days. So that's a nice improvement, 9% down on cost, and an improvement in number of days, and time is money, so that makes sense that those two would correlate. Now, let's look at the other side of this. You know, it's not only going to be good news, there's going to be a mixture of bad in here. Well, the U.S. numbers for this, that was down 9%. Guess what happened in the U.S.? It's actually up 9%, the costs were. So our number for the average data breach in the U.S. is 10.22 million, more than twice what the global number is. Now, why is it so much more expensive for data in the U.S.? Well, one reason is because regulatory fees went up. So we have situations where penalties and things like that need to be paid. Another thing was that we found that detection costs were up. So these two contributed. That's probably not the whole story, but those were certainly contributors to this. So we have some improvement. We have some areas that we still need to improve. Now, if we're talking about areas we need to improve, you can make the biggest difference if you find the things that are costing the most. So what of the data breaches, what are the sources that are causing us to have the most expensive data breaches? Well, it turns out insiders are number one, and almost in a dead heat tie are third parties. So think about insiders are the ones who already are in your environment. They know where all the good stuff is. They don't have to trip around in the dark, and they can use their superior knowledge and access to do a lot of damage. So it's not surprising when they hit that they're able to do a lot of damage. Third parties, they can also essentially be insiders because we open our systems up to them and allow them to come in. So again, they may have advantages, and that's why those data breaches were maybe costing more than some of the others. But another way to look at the most important impactful sources is looking at what was most frequent. And the most frequent at 16% of data breaches was phishing. Phishing, where users or attackers are trying to come after users and get their credentials in most cases so that they can then log in and steal data and things like that. So here, we still have a lot of room for improvement in these areas. And if we want to make improvement to these numbers, I would suggest these are the areas that we really want to focus on. For the first time this year, the Cost of a Data Breach report took a look specifically at AI, artificial intelligence, and what was its impact on data breaches. So if we look at attackers who leveraged AI, well, we found that they were involved in 16% of breaches. So that's a not overwhelming number, but it's a significant number. It's big enough for us to really start paying attention to, and it's not surprising. A new technology like that comes out, the good guys will use it, so are the bad guys as well. So of that 16%, if we sort of decompose that and go drill into a little more detail, we'll find that 37% related to phishing. So in other words, leveraging AI to do better phishing attacks. Well, that's something we have some experience with. We actually ran an experiment with one of our X-Force researchers who took 16 hours of manual time to build up a well-crafted phishing email. And then we used a chatbot to, for 5 minutes, they worked on generating a similar phishing email. We sent both out, and it was virtually a dead heat in terms of slightly more people picked on the human-generated one versus the chatbot one, but look at the difference in efficiency. In other words, AI is going to keep getting better at wording these things and making them more and more convincing. All the rules that we told people, like looking for bad spelling or grammar errors, please unlearn that from all of those folks, because when people are using AI to generate, attackers are using this to generate their phishing emails, they're not going to have any grammar and spelling errors. It's going to look perfect. So we need to have people not necessarily expecting that to be their primary clue. So that's one thing, and I expect we'll see more and more of that, because it's going to be easier and easier for attackers when they see these kinds of numbers to get those kinds of effects. Another use of AI, generative AI in particular, was 35% of this number had to do with deepfakes. Deepfakes are generated video, audio imitations of a real person or even a fictitious person that are convincing enough to make a person do something that they shouldn't otherwise do. So these can be involved to make a very convincing social engineering attack, as one example, where maybe we pose as an executive in the company, we do a video call with an employee and tell the employee they need to wire certain money over to this special account and do it right now because I'm your boss, and they do it and come to find out it wasn't the boss they were talking to. It was a very realistic looking deepfake of the boss. So those are things that we're going to have to start training people to be more critical of and build more processes around so that we don't have more and more damage from that. Now, over on the other side, so if we look at what did organizations do and what was their effective use of AI, well, one of the things that we found that was a big negative is 63% of organizations that we surveyed and talked to and interviewed did not have a governance policy. So any sort of AI governance policy. Well, think about that. If you're trying to tell your employees that we want to win this race, but we don't know where the finish line is, there's really no way to win. And if you don't have a governance policy or security policy in place, then you really have no way to win because you didn't even know how to define what that is. So that's a negative. More work needs to be done here. On the positive side, what we found is that organizations that have extensive use of AI and automation actually got some real benefits from it. So it's not just theoretical. We actually saw real numbers. In fact, the real numbers that we saw here was that organizations that did that really extensive use of AI and automation, they had their breaches go down by 80 days. That's a significant savings in terms of time. And they had their costs go down by $1.9 million. So time is money, and we saw that play out yet again. So those are the numbers and the results. What can we do to make next year's numbers even better? Okay, so now you've seen the numbers, you've seen the damage. What can we do to do a better job next year? Well, here are some recommendations to consider. One of the things is identity and access management, which traditionally we think about end users here. But there's another area that's also growing in importance, and that's non-human identities. So AI is a big part of what we see going forward, and AI systems like agents and things like that are examples that will have identities because they'll need to log into different things, and they will not be human, even though they'll act like it in many ways. Non-human identities brings up the need for secrets management as well. And in this space, we could be talking about passwords, we could be talking about API keys, we could be talking about cryptographic keys. So there's a lot of different things that fit into the kind of secrets that we need to be able to keep safe and secure if we're going to cut down on these breaches. Remember, what are the bad guys after when they're doing those phishing attacks? And I told you that was the number one type of attack that caused data breaches. Well, they're after user credentials. So these things would help. How about for the actual end users? Well, if the bad guys are trying to steal your password, what's the best defense? Don't have one in the first place. Don't use a password, use a passkey, which is a different type of technology that's based on cryptography and is much more phishing resistant. I've done a video on this, so if you want to learn more about that, you can. But take my word for it, this is a technology that we're seeing growing, and for good reason, because it helps against those phishing attacks. So some other areas that we should take a look at, that where we could make a big difference. Well, we've got, as you could see, AI is a big thing for everyone, the good guys and the bad guys. Everyone's doing some form of AI. But let me tell you, there is no AI without data. So it all begins with data. That means I've got to, if I'm going to get the data right in order to inform my AI, and it's data breach that we're talking about, what kinds of things do I need in place in order to secure my data? Well, one of the first things that I need to look at is discovery. I can't secure what I can't see. And in fact, we have this issue with both. We have AIs that are shadow AIs that are popping up all over the place, unauthorized implementations of AI in the organization, and we're having shadow data popping up all along with it because this data needs to be used to create these models and so forth. So we need to be able to discover all the shadow data, all the shadow AI, because once we discover it, then we can create an inventory of it. We can start assessing what's the security posture and things like that. Also, on the data, I need access controls. I need to make sure that not just anyone has access to it, that if it's in a public cloud, it's not publicly accessible if it's sensitive information. I need to make sure that the data is encrypted so that if someone does get a hold of it, they can't read it. And I also need to be able to monitor the use of this data. Make sure that the people that are accessing it actually have rights and need to be able to do that. And then switch over to the AI side. We've had a point of view on this where we say you need to secure the data, you need to secure the model, that is the large language model or generative models, the machine learning models that you're using, and you need to secure the usage. This is where someone goes into a chatbot, for instance, and types something in. It's a prompt that they're putting in. So we need to be able to guard against prompt injections, which are a way of trying to confuse the AI and get it to do things that it shouldn't. So all of these things will make a big difference. And remember, one of the other things that was an outstanding issue that I mentioned, that 63% of organizations did not have an AI governance and security policy. Well, think about it this way. Governance and security are very closely related to each other. In fact, I've found that if I start talking about AI governance, then if I talk about it long enough, I'm going to end up talking about security and vice versa because of the overlap that's there. There are some different concerns in each of these, but there's also some common area. And therefore, creating a good governance policy for your AI and a good security policy will help with the runaway AI that is popping up all over the place. So if you do these kinds of things, I think we'll be able to come back and revisit this video a year from now with a report that will have even better numbers than last year.